Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Panos Tafas, and I'm the treasurer of the Macedonian Society of Great Britain. I'm deeply honored by the opportunity to introduce our distinguished guest speaker tonight. Sir Basil Markesinis has held tenured professorships at the University of Cambridge, Oxford, Queen Mary College, University College London, Leiden in the Netherlands, and the Law School of the University of Texas Austin, where he now holds the title of Emeritus Professor of Comparative Law. He has also held for several years part-time chairs at the Universities of Paris, Sorbonne and Sac, Munich, Siena, Genoa, Rome, the Cornell Law School, and the Michigan Law School. His 53 books, or more than 53 books, over 150 law articles and over 100 articles have dealt with miscellaneous matters such as law, the traveling of ideas, psychobiography, the classics and art, and have earned him fellowships in the academies of Paris, Belgium, Britain, France, the Netherlands, and Rome, in addition to the Athens Archaeological Society and the American Law Institute, as well as many honorary doctorates from Athens, Ghent, Munich, Oxford, and Paris Sorbonne. In 1997, on the advice of the Lord Chancellor, he was appointed by Her Majesty the Queen as one of her counselors in law. And in the New Year's Honours List of 2005, on the advice of the then Prime Minister, he was knighted by Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II for exceptional services to international relations. For his work, he has also received from the Presidents of France, Germany and Italy the Grand Cross of the Order of Merit of France and Italy, as well as the Grand Officer's Cross with Star of the German Order of Merit, as well as the Insignia of the Commander of the Legion of Honour of France. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Sir Basil Markesinis.
The thing is that the success of the Oedipus Rex leads Euripides to write his own version. His own version, Iocasta, is alive, she doesn't commit suicide. And Iocasta, who accompanies Oedipus in his peregrinations, not the two daughters, and the one and his meaning. So it's a completely different story, but because it only survives in extracts, nobody reads extracts, or very few people read extracts, and therefore you don't know the story, the full story, the variations of the story. And that is the basic problem, and that's why I have to make this introduction to the question of Dionysus, because he's one of the most complicated and perhaps even important gods of ancient Greece. And I say it's very complicated because, as you will see, there are various theories and stories about Dionysus, and they're not the same. But one thing that is there is that Dionysus is part of the Greek mythology, the Greek religion, and the Greek plays and stories written about him from about 12 or 1300 BC, with the earliest examples. Once they thought that it was Thrace of Macedonia, because the movement came from 3 years and Lydia into Thrace and into Macedonia and then to the rest of Greece. But they discovered stones, carvings, linear A and B in Chania, in Crete, which show that it was there already in the 12th century BC. And he was there adored with the supreme goddess of Crete. She's not named, but it's Ariadne, the supreme goddess of Crete. And he's there always with the bulls, because Dionysus sometimes appears in the form of a bull. He changes his shape. And of course, bulls, as you know, are a pictorial symbol for Crete and honey. So it's very interesting, because that's a completely new theory and approach. Did the cult of wine, he was the god of wine, the cult of the vineyards, come from Phoenicia to Crete and from Crete to Europe, to Greece? Or is there also truth to say that a movement from Thrace, Macedonia, and southward Bukvi took place at the same time. Not only that, as we come into the 6th century, 7th century, for example, we have the first appearance, the first new one, Zagreus, he's called, Zagreus, who is connected with the Orphic mysteries in Eleusina. And he is born by Zeus, inseminating his niece, who is the daughter of Hera, of Severny. Zeus becomes a snake, and he inseminates his niece. There is another theory that he might even be his daughter. And Dionysus is born. A century later, we have a completely different myth, the one that we find in Euripides' play. And we have Zeus inseminating Semele. Semele is one of the four daughters that the king of Thebes, Cadmus, had. He had four daughters, Semele, Anavi, Io, and Aphtonoi. Four daughters. He didn't have a son. He had four daughters. Cadmus was a Phoenician. He came from Sidon. He was the brother of Europa. Europa was the woman who was kidnapped by Zeus at the fall of the bull. He left Sidon and he came to Greece to find his sister, but instead of looking in Crete, he started looking in the center of Greece. And finally, Delphi told him, you must create a new city, Thebes, and he's the first king, and he's the person who brings the Phoenician alphabet to Greece, except for the vowels. The Greeks added the vowels, and from then on their language became extremely important. There's some people in our country these days that tell you that Greek is a dead language. It is not. And I can give you examples if you want. It's a vital and lively and powerful language, as is our culture. And it is our duty to protect our culture. It is our duty to teach the young people, whether they are Greek or foreign, of our past. We must know where we belong. And we must respect not only our past, but also we must respect our religion. Because without it, we wouldn't be where we are now. These are important. And will it surprise you? I think it will, but I will mention it nevertheless. That a politician, I won't tell you the country yet, once said that if you don't know what is your origin? What is your background? You can never have an efficient and effective foreign geopolitical policy. Who said that? Ahmed Davutoglu said that about Turkey. Why does it apply to Turkey and not to Greece? Why must we forget? Did you see 2 days ago how moving the ceremony was about the people who gave their lives so that we could have a future? There are very important lessons that one can learn from the past. So what we say is not just history, but it's complicated history. And it's complicated because, as I tell you, we have a new version now. Zeus inseminates Semele. And then he makes a mistake. Because Semele says, I want to see you in all your glory. And that means I want to see you with your thunderbolt, Scarabeus. He comes along and he tries to find a little Scarabeus to start the boom and impress the girl. But he makes a mistake. He burns her. He kills her. And just in time, he manages to remove the child from the womb and transplants it, not in the head. He already had enough of the head. He had used that. He puts it on his thigh, and eventually the god is born. And when the god is born, his sister, who's also his wife, the Greek myths in their original Neolithic form are terribly cruel. They're terribly perverse. They're terribly who's her sister. He's very jealous because her husband is always changing himself into a swan or a snake or an ant or a bull in order to have an affair or an eagle. When he sees a nice young little boy, and though no controls in those days, you see, now we live in an era of a lot of controls. Of course, a reaction has to be done. There has to be some kind of a reaction, but on the other hand, we always run the risk in life, as we try to rectify one mistake, we move the whole debate at the other end and commit a new mistake. We go too far in one way or the other. That's why the second of the Parangemata in Delphi was Vilenava. The first was Grotisatva. Now, what am I saying? She comes. She tries to kill the baby. And Dionysus is moved to Asia Minor and is brought up by the equivalent goddess of Rhea, Kyrene. And then we have the most authoritative, the most clear, the most full, the most reliable account of the Bacchic movement by Euripides after he's left Athens in 411. He can't bear it any longer in Athens. Athens is decaying, Athens is dying, democracy is dying. The people are pedantic, they are boring, they make mistakes. And the greatest mistake which he describes in the women of Troy, there are others. They destroy the temples of the gods. And the two gods, Poseidon and Athena, get together and say, they destroyed our temples, we are going to punish them now, their return back to Greece is going to be very difficult. It is a city in decay. It is a city in transition. It is a city where everything is happening. There's death, there's war, there's disaster, there's refugees, they're homeless, they're widows, they're young children. What am I describing? Greece in 410, 11, 404? Or Europe? Greece of today? Syria, Lebanon, Asia Minor, period of transition, period of uncertainty. A world is dying and the new one has not yet emerged. People are confused. And that's what the Bach is about. Because all those followers of Dionysus are abandoned women, widows, people who are poor, people who no longer have a home, people who are homeless, people who are abandoned. Living in a city which was once was beautiful, the greatest of all cities. And now it is decaying. And in their desperation, they need some palliative. They find it in wine, as modern people find it in drugs. But wine and drugs solves some of the symptoms for a short time, but not the causes. That's why all these people are leaving the cities and following the new god. And then, 3rd century, 2nd century, a growing contact with the East begins. Heresies and other dark movements start coming from the East to Greece. And there's a great exchange. In that context, Christianity begins to emerge. It's a new religion, but it doesn't yet have its own philosophical foundations. The philosophy is provided by Greeks, the Stoics, and the philosophy is expressed in that wonderful man, a Jew who became a Christian and wrote in Greek, St. Paul. One of the deepest thinkers of Christianity and of the world, who brings everything together. And you have a movement in the 2nd century, 1st century, or 1st, 2nd century after the birth of Christ, where a new religion, Judaism, a new religion, Christianity, are trying to find their place in the world and find how they're going to coexist the world of Greece. And nowhere is this done more powerfully, nowhere is the clash more strong than in northern Egypt, Alexandria, where the Greeks were very powerful. So what you see in the 4th century, 3rd century, you see philosophers, Calypis of Alexandria, you see others writing books. There is the book called the Odysseia, written in 495. It is the longest Greek poem. The Iliad and the Odyssey are about 12 to 14,000 verses. This is 22,000 verses. And the effort that all these people are making is, how can they bring together the Dionysian religion, the Greek religion, and the Christian religion? They start finding common things. Both have a god who's born from a human being and a god, Semele and Zeus. Maria, the Virgin, and God. Both have a God who does wonders. Both have a God who is crucified, killed, and yet is resurrected. Both have a ritual in which the wine plays an important part in the religious ceremony. Could the two come together? What is really happening is, and I'm putting things in a very different way, is what is really happening is that in the northern part of Egypt, which is the last stronghold of Hellenism, just before the 3rd, 4th, 5th century, AD, after the birth of Christ, in a period like that, you have an effort to see how the two philosophies, the two religions, can coincide, survive in one way or another. It's a big battle, it's an intellectual battle. But of course, intellectual battles are very difficult to describe to ordinary people if you describe them through myths, through stories. One of the great beauties of the parables of Christ is that they're talking about real and important things, but in a simple way so that simple people can understand them. So that is the background that we have to examine to understand the Dionysian movement, the Bacchic movement, and how it affected life and art in Greece and then the rest of the world. Because they're relevant, most of these things still, in our times. And I want to focus on three things. The really great originality of Euripides in his work. The first amazing innovation in that tragedy is that you have, for the first time, a discussion of the phenomenon which is called repressed sexuality. Sexuality, again, comfortable, difficult, confusing. No legal system ever could organize, structure the legal status of people who were genuine hermaphrodites, not gay, man and wife, man and woman, both sexes in one. They have. The first time this was ever discussed in a legal text was the Prussian Code of 1791. But this is a modern problem. Even today we can't cope with it to decide whether you belong to the male or the female sex and how to handle you. Whether, as you saw, the Church of England recently said that young children in a school at the age of 4 or 5 must be encouraged to discover their own sexuality. I think we're going too far. I think we're becoming a bit crazy. I may be wrong. But that's not the point. The point of a teacher when he lectures is very different from the point of a politician when he talks. A politician talks because he wants to vote. A lawyer talks because he wants to win the case. An academic talks because he wants to make you think. Doubt. Wonder. Explore what's happening and how you can learn from the past before it's too late. Repress sexuality. Freud, who dealt with it in 3 essays on sexuality from about 1894, he never stopped making additions and changes to his 3 essays. And he thought that this is a very serious problem, and if you don't know how to handle it in later stage, it can lead to very serious neuroses in a person who is of a confused sexuality. And that is what applies to Dionysus, the god, and that is what applies to Pentheus, the son of Ahavi, who is the grandson of Calchas, who is the king of Thebes. Even before he meets the new god, whom he's fighting with fanaticism, even before he meets the new god, he hates him. But at the same time, he says, I hear he's good looking. I can give you the lines, but it would make it a very serious, dull lecture. Instead of keeping the tempo, it was very tiring for me, but very enjoyable, I hope, or instructive for you. Because later on, when he sees him, he spends 6 verses admiring this man whom he calls Philiprepis. What a nice skin he has. What beautiful and penetrating eyes he has. What a nice beard he has. 6 lines. 6 lines is a lot, because the whole tragedy. Can you guess? And this is another sign of the genius of the Greeks, that they could write a tragedy, they could write a theatrical piece that would keep the audience engaged. And it was only 1,500 lines maximum, 2 articles in any newspaper. And you read them, you don't understand them if you really go about them the next day. But 2 articles, 1,500 lines, you have this whole plot. And in there, 6 lines about how pretty Pentheus finds Dionysus. And then we have the opposite happening too. Dionysus seems to like Pentheus before he decides to exterminate him, destroy him, and Thebes, and his mother. He tries to convert him to a new religion. And you have, and you find them in the book, some amazing statements exchanged between the two. At one stage, the god gets so cross with the king that he throws him into his palace in Thebes, locks him up in a place where the horses are. And a bull is there, and that's the question. Is that the bull, or is it the god masquerading as a bull? And we have Pentheus fighting with the bull. His heart is palpitating. He's sweating. He's fighting. What is he fighting? Or do we have poets, writers, authors actually telling us that that is, in fact, the first hidden sexual encounter between the god and Pentheus? He may be hallucinating, but many people say that in moments of great stress and difficulty, that's what the psychiatrists and other people say, the chances of hallucination can increase. Pentheus comes out and he says, I see 2 Thebes, I see 2 suns. What's happening? What's happening here? He is gradually degenerating, collapsing. He can't cope. And then the god comes and gets his revenge. He says, why are you agitating? He says, I can't stand what's happening up in the mountain. where the women, the Mananthas, and the other followers of Dionysus are doing. You have descriptions in there. It's the only description we have that is so detailed about what the Bacchae did in the mountains. In Helicon, that's where it takes place. There were two mountains nearby Nassos, and Helicon is where all the bad things are happening. And Helicon is there. And you have women not breastfeeding their children, but giving their milk to baby animals. Their children are not weaned, but the animals get the mother's milk, and their orgies, and there's dancing, and there's sociological material, which I cite in the article, which says that other cultures have used the dancing as a way of getting genuinely excited, the dervishes, or others in America, or even the Anastenarians. So, you see what's happening, and Pentheus wants to go and see them. And the god is going to encourage him to do it because the god wants to destroy him. So he tells him, if you want to go up there, they'll kill you. These women are crazy, which includes his sisters, by the way, and his mother, and his aunts. They've all joined the king and the god against their brother, their nephew, the king. So, what is going to happen here? And then you have a second scene described in the tragedy, which is amazing. I'll dress you up as a woman, so they won't notice you. And there's Pentheus, the king, who's dressed up as a woman, who's going to walk through Thebes, and all his citizens will see him become the laughingstock of his town, so that he can go up the mountain and act like a peeping Tom, see the Mananthas do whatever they do. And again, it's an amazing process psychologically, how Dionysus perverts his mind of thinking. He says, look, I'm protecting you. And the king says, you're right. Look how nice you look, dressed up as a woman. Transvestism. It's a real phenomenon, which in Greece at the time was allowed in moments of initiation ceremonies to a new religion or to a new thing. Why? Because by changing your dress, you're also changing yourself. By joining the movement, you were actually indicating to the world that your philosophy was changing. You were open. And you can, if you read it, I have a book here, and you can see how marked it is, but I don't want to spend the time giving you those examples. What do you have? You have the king saying, am I well dressed? Is my hair as nice as my sister? Do I walk? Am I chic? Am I better looking than my sister? He's being degraded in the process of discussing this phenomenon, which has not appeared in any literature before. That's one of the great innovations of this tragedy. The second one is the distinction that Euripides makes between the way individuals think and the way masses think. That difference was not discussed by sociologists or philosophers until the French Revolution. Nobody had noted the difference that you as an individual could react logically, but once you were put together with a big group, you lose your ability to be logical and follow the mass. Well, it happened in the French Revolution. Euripides, one of the historians, gives us a fantastic and gruesome example when the people occupy the Bastille, which is unguarded, only 12 soldiers there, and the governor. And they find the governor, the Bastille, the symbol of cruelty of the mob. they find the governor, and as they're walking around, they trip over his sword because it's sticking out. And immediately the crowd turns around and says, "That's treason, we must kill him. Who will kill him?" And they look around and they find in the group a butcher who has a knife, a butcher's knife. They say, "You kill him, because you have the knife." And how did he respond? Because he's part of this excitement, this paranoia, the excitement. He says, "Well, if the country wants me to do this, it is my duty to obey." He brings out the knife. He carves jihadist jaw. Not in Iraq or Syria 10 years ago. In a great tragedy described by Euripides. And an example which shows that the reaction of people when there's a mass is no longer logical. And of course, that continues throughout the 19th century, and it is studied by lecturers and speakers. And they finally develop a theory. How does this intoxication of the masses take place? Euripides has said it in a tragedy. What has he said? Three things. One, you have a simple message, not complicated. People, the masses, can't understand subtleties. A simple message. And two, you repeat it over and over again until it spreads like a medical disease. And three, the person who does it, the leader, is always there. You know what? The Marche is the only tragedy in ancient Greece, where the god who causes all the problems is in the play from the very beginning to the very end. He is there applying his theory, he is there intoxicating people, perverting their thinking and leading them to crime. There's a marvelous book by a professor, psychiatrist, Dr. Jost Merlot, a Dutchman who practiced in Holland before the war, during the war, and after the war. And he saw, and he's described it, the destruction of the human mind is the title of his book. It's worth reading. He saw how the German propaganda worked. And it worked in the way, briefly, because all this is done in 1390 lines is the length of the Vakya, and then 20 lines missing. 1400. We saw it in Nuremberg. There isn't a better example of this theory, of this organization of the crowds on a huge scale, where a simple message leads them to behave in a truly frightening, insensitive, dangerous manner. And is that the end of it? No. Because now we have other occasions where people can get together and they can be misled. You can have huge pop concerts and drugs. You can have football people gathering and going crazy. You have the social media, which can reach you without you actually being there, but nevertheless applying the same principles and changing you. That is, again, a novelty which has never been discussed before and is not going to be discussed until the 19th century, because of the French Revolution and because of the Revolution of 1848. So, you see, the kind of innovations that we have in one tragedy, which is the result of the phenomenon I just told you, the collapse of a society. textually, but sociologically and psychologically. That is new, but the impetus, the idea, the urge to do it like that is not mine. It comes from one of the greatest classical scholars that Oxford had, Professor Dawes, who was a professor, Regius Professor of Classics in Oxford for many years in the 50s and 60s, and he said, textually, kiminika, the tragedy has been analyzed over and over again. If you want to say something new, you must look at it from a different angle, sociological, political, psychological, but different. We are not undermining the work of the true, real scholars, the classicists. We are aiding it. They're afraid. When I lecture and I've been and I've spoken to them, they're very defensive. We are classicists. We're not interested in psychology. Psychology is not a proper science. Psychology or psychiatrist, it's not for us. We can't rely. But you can't reject in life something simply because you've never tried it and tested it. St. Paul, first epistle to the Thessalonians, panda dokimazete to kalokate. And you know what? I had to go to England and study classics in England to notice something that I hadn't noticed when I heard the original words spoken to me in Greek. Panda dokimazete. Rai, ohi. Δεν λέει δοκιμάζεται. Μ' αρέσει ο κολάτο, δεν μ' αρέσει η βανίλια. Το πετάω. Λέει, το υποβάλλετε σε δοκιμασία. Για να περάσει το τεστ, το κρατάτε. Γι' αυτό και η αγγλική μετάφραση είναι τόσο σημαντική. Διότι τι λέει η αγγλική μετάφραση. Probe everything. And keep the best. Πάντα δοκιμάζεται το καλό κατέχει. We are bringing in a new science in the study. Why? To help the existing tools. I used to teach in Oxford for years, law and economics. In my opinion, it makes sense. A decision the court takes into account not only the rights of A and B, but also the economic consequences of such an action. The wider interest in the litigation between you and you. Many of my colleagues, even in that great university, were saying, no, not too much, economics. Well, all I know is that I had a class which was two or three times the size of this audience, because the students were interested. And that is another thing, another lesson for me, which is very important. We have to find ways to make the teaching of subjects like classics, the teaching of our history in a way that's relevant and modern and new and appealing. Otherwise, we lose our audience. I remember I was the age 8 or 9, and I had my father, my dear father, who insisted in teaching me himself ancient Greek and religion. He would go for his siesta at 2 and leave me so much to read, and when he woke up, before he went to Parliament, he would examine me. Ah, that's not easy. That's painful. This was very demanding. Not at all easy. And I remember how cross he would get because he said, what did Christ say in the Gospel of St. Matthew? And he would stop and say, listen, the Gospels don't, they may describe the same things, but they're not speaking in the same language. There's fine differences. You have to learn how to read a text. You have to learn to notice the differences. So what does he say to Peter when he says, oh, you would betray me too. You like everyone else. Do you remember that? You all know it. You're nodding. Greek. Whatever. But I want somebody to tell me exactly how it's said. I can't do all the work. I must do something. Πριν αλέκτο φωνήσει. Λάθος. Γιατί, όχι δεν είναι τρεις, το τρεις είναι σωστό. Αλλά στο Ματθαίο είναι, and I was 9 years old and I suffered. Long may God look after my dear father, but I suffered. Πριν αλέκτορα φωνήσε τρεις απαρνήσιμοι. Because he used to tell me, this is the απαρέμφατο του αορίστου and it takes things in the αιδιατική. Who? More or less correct. You avoided it because you are a woman. Πώς το λέει η Νασιανή? Πώς το λέει η Νασιανή? Όταν ο Θεόφιλος τη βλέπει, πώς το λέει εκείνεκος? And she replies very cleverly, Εκυνεκός, μηγάζει.
Another psychiatrist, friend of mine from Harvard,
in New York said, take away Shakespeare and 50% of Freud disappears. Take away the Greek myths and the other 50% goes up in a puff of smoke. I don't know if it's right, but I didn't say it. Professor of Psychiatry said it at Harvard University, Bennett Simon. And he continues here, second, the psychotherapy seen in the back here, this is, I'm quoting, is clinically flawless and persuasive. It would bear comparison with any modern summary of a psychotherapy written by a professional clinician. And what does the father do? What the Kobuyanikas, what the quacks, what the shamans, the laymen, the untrained doctors in Macedonia did at the time, because they were the first to receive this phenomenon, and they were the first who had to study how the women would go into a state of ecstasy, and after that they would be uncontrollable. And the answer is achieved with patience, with impartiality, with observation, and with every possible attempt to take the patient back into reality. You will read against the book. I'm not here to read my book or the tragedy, where the father asks her, when he sees her like that in the head, mi primo, chieda tuo cuore a noi, e chieda tuo figlio, look at the son. Nothing to do with the murder. And she replies, yes. How do you feel? I already feel different. Better or worse? Okay. Who was your husband? She remembers him. And do you have a child? Says yes. Now, apparently, according to psychologists and psychiatrists, in cases like that, what you want to do is to get the patient to admit himself that that's what he's holding, the head of his son. It's no good for the patient to say, they tell me it's the head of my son. That's what the psychiatrists I cite there actually say. And Anami responds in that way because she wants to avoid the responsibility. Her subconscious is telling her that for as long as you deny remembering the details of what has happened, you will not be responsible. So she says, Mulene, or the Gradana Mildari. And the father comes back and says, now look, look carefully. What is it? And I'm abridging now, 2 pages, but only 2 pages again. She shrieks, she shouts, and says, my God, it is my son. It's all compressed. One of the people who has dealt with this is Professor Georges Devreux. He's a French, Hungarian, Huguenot, professor at the Sorbonne, who wrote about classics and psychiatry. He's very learned, and those who have met him, he's dead now, described him to me as a quiet, nice, easygoing man. And he said part of what I read out to you before. He said, this way is the way that a psychiatrist must act, not excitable, not with passion, not with a hurry, in a hurry, but a gradual effort to bring the patient back into contact with reality. Now, I am not a psychiatrist, but when I read psychiatrists of that decision, dealing with cases like that and speaking so emphatically, at the very least I say, well, there's something here worth looking into. And it helps me excite my audience. You know how difficult it is to stand before an audience for 1 hour? teaching in Texas, I was teaching 8:30, 9:30, 9:30, 10:30, 10:30, 11:30, 11:30, 12:30, 12:30, 1:30. Exhausting. But it's exhausting also for the students, the audience. You have to keep them awake. You have to keep them interested. You have to engage them if you want the subject, if you want our culture, if you want our history, if you want our religion to survive. You don't abandon the basic dogmas, but you adapt what you teach, how you teach, and you make sometimes compromises, even in religion. Otherwise, you're facing people who would be very extreme and cause harm in general. So, I want to try and bring all this to an end and show you some pictures. Because sometimes you know music or pictures can help illustrate something in a better way than just words on abstract ideas. What I have there is an ancient 6th century vase, which tells you why, if you want to explain to an audience Greek tragedy through Greek pottery, you have great difficulties. And you guess why? This is fairly clear, but not entirely clear. The difficulty is that Greek pottery describes not just one event, but history, a whole series of events, in a very small space, which is the circumference of the vase. Now this one sometimes will depict somebody with his external signs, a man with a trident or cider, a woman with a helmet, Athena. But sometimes like this one, what is it? Now look at the difficulty. That's the whole circumference of the vase. That is why in my book, which I left there, I talk about Greek art and mythology by looking at the Renaissance and Baroque art, where you have something more clear as you see the middle. So, this is meant to be Menelaus threatening to kill Helen. It's taking place in the Trojan War, where the Greeks have burned Helium. And suddenly, Menelaus, hot-blooded, sees his wife and wants to kill her. But Homer observes and understands humans and their nature. He knows that Menelaus is weak, and all it takes is for his wife to expose her breasts, and he changes his mind. He doesn't kill. Then you have a warrior return who holds a child from the leg and is threatening an old man. The old man is Priya. It's another part of that play. That's why it's all compressed. Priam is murdered in a temple. The gods get cross because it's a sacrilege to kill somebody in the temple. And the child he's holding is Astyanax, the son of Hector. Why kill the child? So that there's no chance that the dynasty can revive. Brutality. Brutality. Nastiness. Throughout the Byzantine history, emperors, upon becoming emperors, would kill or blind their brothers and send them to the monastery in order to prevent a claim for the throne. So here is Neoptolemus. Well, why Neoptolemus? Euripides tells us it's Odysseus who threw him off the walls of Troy and killed the child. And the other two women, we don't know. Now, sometimes you have what I say, the Baroque pictures, which make things very clear. This is Sebastiano Ricci, Baroque actor, Italian, who depicts the moment where Zeus fertilizes Semele, but also kills her with his thunder. It's an amazing picture, not least because the choice of colors, the yellows, depict this thunder with ears. The gorge that collects the clouds. Wonderful descriptions in one word. A Greek talent. A few other races have that. They could create an image, an eternal image with one word. La bella, Iorelle. How does Homer describe her?
Such loveliness men should die
and city should be sacked. Now, here, Stanley Wall, Prime Minister in the 30s, is actually referring to the third book of the Iliad. When Helen comes on the walls of Troy to see the duel between her former husband, Menelaus, and Paris, Alexander. And Helen appears covered in a white silk cloth and never utters a word. And all the old men and the king turn around and they say, "My Lithia, after the Arthur." And on the basis of no word, what a talent for any author, not to spend words, by saying nothing, he said so much as to excite generations for centuries later. What culture, what talent it takes to be able to speak in this way, and by saying nothing, he creates an image. You can find philosophers who agree with this, Quintilian, you can find Lessing, who agrees that in his book on love and war, you can find all sorts of people. When I chose a politician, and I chose a politician 2,500 years later, because it is so marvelous. It is Greek. It is ours. And we don't know how to use it and exploit it. Now, let me take you to one famous vase, which is clear that it's Dionysus. It is by one of the greatest sculptors of Greece in the 6th century BC, Ezekiel, and it is Dionysus in the ship. And the story was inspired because in the February of every year, the Greeks had the Anthesteria. They had a feast for the ripening of last year's wine. And even slaves and women were allowed to attend. They were all drunk. For the sake of Dionysus. By the way, the Greeks, as you know, watered the wine. It was 2-1, or 3-1. It was not plain. But he's lying on a beach in Naxos, and this ship of pirates goes by. They grab him, and they threaten to kill him. So he does a theophania, his epiphany. He becomes the god, and he orders for wine to grow everywhere between the oars, so the oars can't move, and cover the ship. And he's immediately surrounded by his favorite tigers. And the sailors, the pirates, panic and jump into the water. They become dolphins and they disappear. Now, a vase like that by Ezekiel is priceless. And it would depend how he signed it. If he was the potter, the man who just made the pottery, he would just say, Ebi, sir. If he was the artist who painted it, he would sign, Hegas. There are only 8 of his that have the double signature, and they're priceless. But not in all the cases was it right. The next picture I want to show you is Dionysus. It is the only piece of sculpture that I know by Michelangelo which has attracted uniform criticism. It was done at the age of 19. So can you say he was too young? No. Because at the age of 20, he did one of his greatest masterpieces, the Pietà, in St. Peter's, where the young virgin, Maria, holds in her arms the dead Christ, where the mother is younger than the son, because the old myth was that the virgin never grew old. And her eyes are closed eyelids because she's completely controlled and she doesn't want even to give the impression that she's crying. So it's on the edge. What's wrong about this statue? Well, the first thing that everyone said from Basil, who was the artist of the 16th century who wrote the lives of the great painters of the Renaissance, that it was too effeminate. He pointed at his chest and stomach and said that it was too effeminate. It was. But that's what Euripides had spent so much time describing in his play. And then modern people came and said that, mechanically speaking, this leg here to the left is too awkward, and if you really had a real person in that position, he would fall over. It's inaccurate in terms of balance. But nevertheless, it is an amazing sculpture which brings out a theme which Euripides brought out, as I told you, in the play. This next picture is the dismemberment of Menthes. His mother and his aunt, Inor and Aravi, are pulling him to bits. If you read the Greek text, it's terrible, because she says she puts her foot on his arm and puts the other foot there and pulls the arm out of its socket. It's the most marvelous description. But that's the religion, and that religion is followed by people. Why? Because they're lost, they're confused, they have no guide. They're trying to escape from the problems of a decaying society, of a dying world before the new one has appeared. So, a god that is around for 1200 years, a god that is so confusing and difficult, a god with different parents, a god who's barbarous and cruel, a god who can mislead people and drive them crazy. Well, all these are good details if you want to be a scholar. You can read all these details. But is there a picture that I would like to leave you with? Yes. The details are there if you want to be a scholar, if you want to be an educated person. But I would like to leave you with a picture which is romantic, where the theme is love. Christian. And here is the marvelous piece, by common consent, the most important painting by Titian, painted when in 1521. And what you have there is Dionysus, who's jumping out of his chariot because he sees on the island of Naxos the abandoned Ariadne. Myth and mythology. Theseus, the hero, he's a bastard. She saves him. She helps him kill the Minotaur. And he abandons her. He's a bastard. He rapes Hippolyta and has with her the illicit son, Hippolytus. And then he kills her. In Phaedra, in Hippolytus, the tragedy, he's never there. He's philandering with other women. In Phaedra, Hippolytus, he's completely different from his son. In a moment of excitement, he writes a letter to Poseidon, and he says, kill my son Hippolytus, kill my son Hippolytus, because he tried to make love to his mother. False. He reacts too quickly. He discovers it. And then the end of the tragedy, he spends all his time trying to get the innocent son to forgive him instead of trying for himself to understand the son who has spent all his life under the stigma of illegitimacy. No question of forgiveness by him. Back again to the words, Synonymy, and the religious word, Aphesy. Aphesy is something more than Synonymy. There's no problem. I do this, you do that. There's complete, if you read again Paul, St. Paul, you will see that the Aphesy comes from Christ because of two qualities that he describes in two beautiful Greek words. One is because Christ is, there are two words. One is that he's praus, wonderful word, praus. Στόση είναι praus. Αν το praus είναι η λέξη που εμένα μου αρέσει πάρα πολύ, γιατί είναι μια λέξη που δεν χρησιμοποιείται συχνά. And the other one is, he is μιλίχιος. You see, you know, two words that have come into the vocabulary. They didn't exist in the Greek vocabulary before the 4th and 5th century BC. They have come in with the Stoics and later with Christianity. And that's the complete forgiveness which the Son, who's died because of the Father's impetuosity, gives to the Father. But the Father, who has, through his impetuosity, killed the Son, doesn't give to the Son. I think it's amazing. And here, Ariadne sees him and falls in love with her, and he falls in love with her, and says immediately, my queen, I'll take your crown and put it in the heavens. You see the stars up at the top left corner. He takes that and he throws the crown, and you'll be my queen forever. And he had many children with her. Yes, the god, the cruel one. Yes, you have that, you have the other. I tell you, I want to finish on a nice story. And you know where you find that story said, expressed, as I told you? In an opera. In an opera that perhaps not all have heard. You again. Well done. Oh, you've read the book.
I've seen the opera.
I've seen the opera. And who did the music? Strauss. And you have a wonderful scene. The first is the queen abandoned in Naxos. And she sings an aria which is very moving. It is Erpis ein Reich. There is a country, a state somewhere where peace and calm can be found. And that is only death. She's waiting, hell, Hades. She's waiting in the island for the arrival of Hermes to take her to her death. And instead, he comes. And at that stage, you have one of the most beautiful, the most difficult coloratura arias by Zerminetta. Those of you who have read or seen that coloratura aria for a soprano is very difficult. The most difficult one is in The Queen of the Night, in Mozart, in the Magic Flute. The highest notes, the highest E in music. But the Zerbietta aria, what's the title? Groß Machtigen Prinzessin. Great and powerful princess. That's how the poem starts. It lasts 12 minutes. And if you find it through the Google, through the internet, listen to it, because it is so beautiful. And the words are beautiful. Because this ordinary woman, Zerbinetta, goes to the queen who's ready to commit suicide and says, you great and powerful princess, you cry because you've lost your lover. Do you think that an ordinary woman who suffers the same thing suffers any less than you? So, pull yourself together. A just and find another lover. And that is said in this coloratura aria, which lasts 12 minutes. Coloratura is when you have certain notes where instead of continuing with a word, you change it, you color it, you go up and down. It's very, very different. Catherine Dassai is a French soprano. Coloratura is about 65 now, and if you look at it, the internet, you'll find it. It lasts 12 minutes, which it is the most wonderful aria. It's the most wonderful compassion, forgiveness, calming for a frustrated love. An unrequited love, as they always say, a love that was never fulfilled. A kind of love that Aphrodite never expressed. Aphrodite had all sorts of things, but two kinds of love she didn't have, the romantic love and the motherly love. So, there you are. 45 minutes, 50 minutes. A god, complicated, dominating literature, dominating the human imagination for over 1,200 years, maybe 2,000 if you go up to 500 AD. All in a tragedy, which if you study and think, can have lots of lessons that are appropriate even to our times. Thank you.
Καλησπέρα σας. Βρισκόμαστε με τον κύριο Αγαμέμνον Αποστόλου. Πείτε μας δύο λόγια για την απόψινη βραδιά.
Την απόψινη βραδιά είχαμε την τιμή να έχουμε τον κύριο Βασίλη Μαρκεζίνη, ο οποίος μας εξέθεσε κάποια ζητήματα της ψυχολογίας που βλέπουμε στην τραγωδία του Ευρυπίδη. Κυρίως στην τραγωδία των Βακχών, όπου συνδέει κάποιες από τους στίχους του δράματος, που έγινε στην αρχαιότητα με ηθικά και ψυχολογικά μηνύματα που μπορούμε να τα αντικατοπτρίσουμε στην εποχή μας.
Σας ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ. Να είστε καλά.
Παρακαλώ.